The EG4LL battery is probably the most popular server rack battery on the market, and today we're going to find out if that's because it's good, because it's cheap, or if it's just overhyped. So we've had a couple of these EG4LL batteries kicking around for a couple months now. We've put some miles on them and we feel like we're in a good position to tell you guys what we like, what we don't like, and also just go over some of the results of our baseline tests that we put these batteries through. As always, you guys know here at the lab, our opinions cannot be bought. If you're interested in any of the stuff we talk about in today's video, there will be links in the description down below. Otherwise, we're gonna jump into a super quick 2-minute teardown for everyone that is not already familiar with the EG4LL batteries. So this is the 48 volt, 100 amp hour EG4LL battery. This bad boy comes in at 99 pounds. It does pass the tiny baby lift test, but not without a quick finger pinch. This is a 100 amp hour battery at 51.2 volts, which classifies it as a 48 volt battery, and also means it's a 5,120 watt system. For anybody looking at batteries, if you do the volts times the amps, you'll know how many watt hours you're actually gonna get out of that battery. And you can actually run up to 64 of these batteries in parallel, which gets you at 327.6 kilowatt hours just off of these, which is insanely high. This thing is built with lithium iron phosphate batteries, which everything should be nowadays, and it has a 7,000 cycle life at 80% depth of discharge, or 5,000 cycles at 100% depth of discharge, which just means it's gonna last you a long time. And when it comes to the build, it's an IP20 rating, so it's not water resistant or anything. Don't put it in your pool. It has the nice little foldy handles on the side. You got your positive terminals right here, your negative terminals, both of which are recessed, which is nice. And then you got communication ports running up and down the side. There's a ground screw over here. You obviously have your power on and off, which is just for the BMS. There's actually a breaker to turn on power to the actual terminals. And you have a nice little touchscreen that doesn't do a whole lot, but it lets you see what's going on just from a glance. You don't need to fire up an app or anything unnecessary. And of course, the entire casing is like a nice heavy metal, so it's somewhat durable. And when you go ahead and rip the front plate off, you can see everything behind here is super nice and well organized. You got your two fire arresters, and you also have your temperature sensors, because this battery has certain temperature range that it's supposed to run in and charge in and discharge in, which we will get to in the testing later on. And you can get all this for $15.99. Right now it's actually on sale for $12.99, and it's been on sale for $12.99 for like a long time. That's probably like the retail price of it, which makes this $253 per kilowatt hour, or 25 cents per watt hour at the sale price, which is a pretty good deal. Jumping into the testing, one of the most important things for us to know is if the temperature sensors and all that actually work in real life situations. We live in a cold climate, and if we were to leave these batteries in a cabin, in a house, the power's off and there's no heat on, they will get extremely cold during the winter time. And it's one thing to take the temperature sensor and submerge it in something cold. It's another thing to have the battery be cold and see how it reacts as a unit itself. So, first test, we threw this thing in a deep freezer and we left it there for 24 hours. And we got the cells down to a temperature of negative 27 degrees Celsius, as they were reading at least on the screen right here, which is not unrealistic. We've seen temperatures as low as negative 16 degrees Fahrenheit, which is basically the equivalent. It says on the sticker right here that it'll discharge up to minus 20 degrees Celsius. I believe it won't take a charge after like 0 degrees Celsius or something like that, but it'll still work if it gets cold. So we got it down well below the minus 20 degrees Celsius. It also has a high end of that scale for if you were to live somewhere like Arizona and you just leave this in your driveway to melt right through it, which is about 167 degrees Fahrenheit. Turn it on, it threw on the alarm light right away, so I knew we were probably gonna be all right. I went ahead and connected a battery charger up to it and it just refused to charge. It just said protecting. It wouldn't accept a charge at all. And when you went ahead and flipped on the breaker and you go ahead and read the voltage coming out of here, there's nothing. There's like micro amounts coming out. But if you do the same test with a warm battery, it'll read the 52 or 53, whatever it's at, volts, which is cool. That's good news. I like to know it works. And I like to know that even though the temperature sensors are deep down in there, they still recognize the temperature and will control the battery, because lithium iron phosphate is not supposed to do anything when it's cold. It's just not good to keep it cold. Next up, this battery is rated for 100 amp hours. You can run this battery at a full load of 100 amp hours, which is 5,120 than 120 watts, and it will have no problems with that. That's how we ran our efficiency test. Anything over is technically an overdraw. So we threw a couple loads at it, and it did not bad. It was able to last about 30 seconds at 130 amps, which is pretty good. So if you accidentally overloaded this, it should give you enough time to realize that you're making the mistake before it trips. And then the second end of that test was just consistently overloading it and seeing if we could get the breaker to pop, but we could not. It was always the BMS. It's a way quicker acting system. I believe this will come in if the BMS fails, and once this gets warm, it pops. But in our testing, we could only ever get the BMS to recognize it. We couldn't make it overexert itself for long enough to actually trip the physical breaker. This is just more of a switch, like on and off switch. And in terms of efficiency, it's a 100 amp hour battery. We ran a 99 amp hour load, which over time slowly creeped up. So it should have lasted about an hour. It lasted exactly an hour. So it does give you a little bit of problem if you're trying to run it right there near the end of the battery life. It kind of spikes in terms of what it's registering for amp hours. I believe that's just the batteries given everything they got, and then they overwork themselves. Your amp hour rating goes from like 99 across the board to like 105, which then makes this trip and shut off, which it did do a couple times during the test. Luckily, I was there to stop the timer and set it all back, but overall, it lasted 1 hour, which is great. It means the battery is 100% efficient. And given that information, if you're just here saying, what the hell can this battery do? I just wanna run my oven, run a microwave, run my air conditioner. This battery will run the true 5,120 watt hours. You can run a 1,500 watt load for like 3 hours and 25 minutes. Obviously, everyone's loads are unique to them, but it's a good battery. It'll stand up to pretty much whatever you throw at it, and it's safe. And in terms of what we don't like about this battery, I really tried to make a list of things that I don't like, but it was hard. There's not a lot. The one thing that I despise about this battery is, and I know I said that I like this and the things we like, how the terminals are kind of hidden and they're not gonna shock you, whatever. They have this little ridge that sticks out so you can put your plastic cover over it. Good job, that was thought out. This folds out of the way so you can get your wires there nicely or do a little tuck, good job. But when you pick it up, it jams your fingers up against this. I don't think I've been able to move this battery without jamming my fingers to the point where they actually hurt. You shouldn't have to move this thing a lot at the end of the day, but I'm like a medium-sized guy, so if you got big burly hands and you're trying to pick this thing up, you're gonna have instant regrets. Other than that, there's nothing we don't like.
Picked it up before?
Yeah.
We recommend this.
This was a hard list to make, and we only got one thing on it. When it comes to things we like about the EG4 LL battery, we found a pretty good amount of them, which is probably why this is such a popular battery. And I would say the first thing that we really, really like about this thing is it's just so easy to set up and build into a full system. When it comes to setup, you have your dip switches on the front, and the manual tells you exactly where to set them depending on how you're configuring your system. Very straightforward. Other than that, there's nothing else you have to do other than plug in your wires, maybe ground it depending on how you have it set up, and maybe put a communication wire depending on what kind of inverter you're hooking it up to. Otherwise, EG4 sells full server racks with bus bars built into them and everything for this system, and it's extremely expandable. You could buy one, you could buy two, you could buy 50, and you could still have room to put more on top, which we really like. A lot of other batteries and systems are not meant to, they're server rack batteries, but they don't build into a system the same way. They're not as easy to use. They don't go together very nicely. You can't expand them as much. So that is one of the biggest things that we really like about this battery. Next up, I like the terminals right here. I like that they are kind of recessed. The actual connection happens below the surface of the front of the battery, which just makes it super safe. I know like jackupper batteries and stuff have the bolts sticking way out at you. If you were to walk by with something and bump into it, you would technically ground the unit out and you would shock yourself or whatever you touched it with, depends what you're doing. Point is, that won't happen with this because the connections are safe, they're tucked away, they don't stick out, and we really like that. I like that there's two connections. Some other batteries only have one positive and one negative lead. So if you're running a single battery system, like if you just have one in a shed or a small cabin or something, then you're trying to run an inverter and a charge controller off the battery, you then have to either get a bus bar or you have to start stacking connections onto the one lead. There's just like multiple wires and it gets messy. So I like that there's two here. It makes it easier to add more stuff to just one battery and keep it kind of clean and organized. We also really like the screen on this. There's two things we like. We like the screen, and we like that the batteries are sold in multiple options, and one of the options is without a screen. So if you don't want that, you can save like 150 bucks or whatever it is and get this battery without the screen. I really like the screen because I like looking at the battery at a glance and seeing what's happening, what percentage is it at, what's it discharging at, whatever. Where some of the other ones, you might need an app or you might need something else connected to it to show you what's going on the battery, which is fine. It just adds a layer of, I don't want to do that to find out what's going on the battery. I want to walk up and touch it. So I like the screen, and I really like that if you don't like the screen, you could save some money and get it without the screen. And the final thing that we really like about the EG4 system in general is we got this from Signature Solar. That's probably where most of you guys are going to get your battery EG4 supplies from. And we all know, we're all aware that all of this stuff comes from overseas. It's labeled right on the side of it. But some of it has been restructured for us to better understand here in North America. And this is one of those products. When you call support, you're gonna speak to someone in the States and they have your answers really, really quickly. We tried this, we demoed it, and it actually worked. They just threw answers at us like they already knew them. They were very easy to connect to. There was not a lot of wait time, that kind of stuff. And the manuals and everything for this are very easy to follow and understand. Some of the other stuff in the market, it might be the same, but it's not, because when you're trying to set it up and you open the manual, you can't understand anything that's inside of it. And then when you try to call the company for help, it doesn't go well. We had a rough start to the week with those exact experiences. So at the end of the day, if you were to buy this from Chop Solar, Signature Solar, somewhere like that, you're gonna actually get support, which we really, really appreciate, especially when you might be jumping into a system that you're building that you have never done before and you don't know what it is you're doing. It's nice to have someone that can actually help you. We have come to the conclusion that this is one of the most popular batteries because it's good and it's cheap. The price is really good, to be honest. It isn't overhyped. It performed the way we thought it would, and we've really enjoyed using it. If you're looking to buy these batteries individual, or if you're trying to bundle this into a full kit and build a system, we'll leave some links down below. You can check out Signature Solar, Chop Solar. They put together all the kits and components and everything that you need. Otherwise, thank you guys so much for watching. Make sure you are subscribed if you are not already, and I will catch you guys in the next one. Peace out and stay charged.